Okay, so let's start. So good afternoon, everybody. The goal of this tutorial is to provide an overview of the two tools which are basically mainly required to run both deep neural network workloads and general purpose software on the pulp simulator, which is called GVSOC. In particular, we are planning four different trainings. So this will be the first one of a series of tutorials. And in this one, we will basically show a startup tutorial on the two tools. So basically understand how to run the bug and profile deep neural network and the general purpose code on GVSOC and let's say basic things such as profiling and debug. On the other hand, we are planning to have more in-depth tutorials about GVSOC, which is the pulp simulator, the SDK, which is the software environment, and Dory, which is the tool used to deploy deep neural networks on pulp architectures. And the goal of the fourth one will be not only to understand how to use it as a user, but also to understand deeply the internal architecture and behavior, and being able to extend pulp platforms with additional accelerators and peripherals. Then the one about the SDK will be focused on the SDK structure, so how to extend the SDK with an additional target, such as an additional chip we might want to do with a different configuration in terms of number of cores, peripherals, or accelerators, and also on how to use the PMC's library, which is the library of functions to write optimized code for pulp architectures, and how to write this code. And finally, the third tutorial will be on Dory, and it will be on how to customize and add blocks to deep neural networks in this tool, and especially adding blocks which are not already supported by the tool. The agenda for this meeting is the following. There will be a first presentation on GVSOC by Nazareno, approximately 45 minutes, but we have quite a lot of time, so it might be take longer. And here Nazareno will first introduce the pulp platform, then introduce GVSOC, and then provide an hands-on session showing how to use the simulator with let's say examples with increasing complexity. Then a Q&A session will follow. Here we allocated up to 45 minutes because we have 3 hours overall, but it can take less. And the second part is related to Dory, and it will be given by Alessio. Again, 45 minutes. And Alessio will introduce the pulp DNN flow, including NeMo, Dory, and the PulpNN. Then it will provide an in-depth overview of the Dory templates already available and their mapping into the PulpNN backend, which is the optimized library for running deep neural network on pulp architectures. And finally, we show some hands-on examples on network generation. So the tutorials will be registered, not the Q&A session. So please turn off your camera during the session of tutorials. Okay, so now I let Nazareno start the first part of the tutorial.
Okay, thanks. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Check. Okay. Yes. Okay, perfect. Okay, let me share the screen. Okay. Okay, so hello everybody. My name is Nazareno Bruschi. I'm a PhD student at the University of Bologna. And as Davide said, I'm going to show how you can run applications for Pulp using our simulator named GVSOC. GVSOC is a completely open source tools available within our SDK in Pulp Platform project on GitHub. And in this project, we release every specific part to develop applications exploiting all Pulp features. And to better understand the following examples, let's start with a slide about Pulp architecture. Okay. Okay. So a typical Pulp architecture is constituted by two parts, a microcontroller unit that, thanks to its tiny RISC-V-based core, called the Fabric Controller, and unoptimized I/O interfaces called MicroDMA, manages the external communications. Moreover, this region contains a large memory space to store the data. And the second part is a cluster of identical RISC-V-based cores that, like a peripheral, could receive from Fabric Controller high computational workload in order to speed up the execution, exploiting the parallelism over the core. The cluster is composed also by an ultra-fast tightly coupled data memory organized in banks that directly communicates with optimized DMA to move the data between two regions without limiting the core's executions. The cluster is also equipped by an extraction cache, which can be used to exploit NIMD or SIMD computational paradigm, and other set of peripherals like event unit, controllers, and controller stuff. Finally, the cluster could also have hardware accelerators directly connected to the peripheral interconnect to communicate with the cores and to the memory to fetch the data directly. Custom accelerators could also be designed and easily built thanks to a common interface for the cluster of Pulp. In both regions, there is our RISC-V-based cores named RISC-V, which is a four-stage in order and single issue core, with a set of instruction set architecture extensions optimized for digital signal processing and linear algebra operations. Some of those are load and store with post incrementing, hardware loop, SIMD operations, and bit manipulation, and many others. We also release a specific toolchain based on GNU compiler and RISC-V target that should be used to correctly compile and optimize the code for Pulp, exploiting all of these extensions mentioned before. This is not, the toolchain is not directly included in the Pulp SDK, but you can easily find it in Pulp Platform project and after there is also a link. Okay, GVSOC, as I said before, is a simulator and consists in a C++ program which takes the binary generated from the compiler and executes this code, simulating the chip target hardware. For this reason, it's very useful, especially to develop drivers or complex computational kernels and other applications that have to use the whole system and not only to evaluate the correctness of the code. It also has a complete instruction set simulator based on RISC-V core and PULP extensions, perfectly suited to run our applications. Thanks to its hardware-oriented model, it could be potentially extended to every one of our park of chips, building existing blocks and modeling a new one with the same idea of the hardware modules. More specifically, GVSOC is a fully event-based simulator in which every component can generate its event at specific time, interacting each other. It's quite powerful because includes a timing model for every relevant blocks of the chip that it's simulating such as memory, interconnect, and so on. But it's still fast because can do about millions of instructions per cycle, so quite fast. It is 100% functionally accurate since we can calibrate it with the real chip or FPGA or RTL simulation, and has a quite good timing accuracy with the target up to 20% of target upper. And here I put a link to a detailed documentation that you can consult, but attention, because the comments could be not updated. GVSOC has also a complete set of system traces to see the execution log, as we will see after in this presentation, and simulates the performance counters using them like application profiler, as profilers. Okay, here we have a graphical view of what is done during an execution of GVSOC or on other available platforms such as RTL simulations and specific real board or FPGA. First of all, with the setup of the environment from the target configuration files, the generators, which is a Python script, build a chip that can be simulated on GVSOC, containing all of the main specification about the target. For example, the number of cluster, the number of core per cluster, the ports, and memory space, peripherals, and so on. The generators build the chip and compile GVSOC using the chip that they are created as container of every useful stuff, such as architecture defines. Then there is the compilation phase that compiles the application code and the runtime functions called PMCs, including those that are specified in the chains in the chain of make files that we can see later. Finally, the execution on a platform that in this case of today is always the default one, so GVSOC. The GVSOC code is basically composed by two blocks: the engines for the time, clock traces and the events, and the models that contain the behavior of every block. At running time, GVSOC can read from JSON files specific parameters to modify the execution. So this is quite useful to change the behavior of some modules without recompile the virtual block. Pulp runtime is a fundamental part to develop applications for Pulp because allow us to use every module without directly managing the low level feature, such as writing the particular register of one IP version, but also to handle properly the operating system things, such as tasks, events, interrupts, memory addressing, and so on. Our software stack is basically composed by three levels. The first is the Pulp OS level, in which every API is mapped on native functions. The second one is the PMCs level, in which they are mapped on the basic native functions. And then the last is the BSP, in which every API is mapped on PMCs and is specific from the device. Basically, they are the drivers for the external devices connected to the SIP via some peripherals. For example, the HyperRAM and the HyperFlash connected via HyperBus. Okay, you can find all these functions in the Pulp SDK, organized briefly as following. In RTOS, you can find the PMCs folder, in which there are PMCs API and PMCs BSP subfolder, which are the second and the third level of the software stack of before. Then you can also find the Pulp OS. You can find the Pulp OS folder, in which you can find the first level and the implementations of the drivers. In this folder, you can also find the Archi folder, which contains every architecture specific references, and the HAL folder, H-A-L folder, which contains the hardware abstraction layer. So basically a set of functions that abstract the hardware register level. Then there is the tools folder, in which there are a gap configs folder that contains the configurations files used by the generators and GVSOC. Contains GAPI folder, which is the Pulp runner to call the specific platform before running the application, and contains GVSOC itself, which are composed by the two main blocks mentioned before, the models and the engines. We have also a useful set of tests to be run on GVSOC, and an application folder in which there is a pre-generated CNN to be run on GVSOC. And the CNN is a mobile network one. As I said before, the PMCs APIs are located in RTOS PMCs folder, and the useful documentation is in the web pages at the link here. And thanks to GreenWave Stacks for the contribution. Every API is anyway commented and described in the header files. So if you want to have a look to them, you can navigate PMC's API folder. Here I put a picture of how it looks like. So you can find the peripheral drivers, the cluster drivers, the operative system functions, and many others. In this slide, I recap the requirements to install and use our main tools for this tutorial and to approach with the Pulp Simulator. So you can find more details in the proper readmes of the repositories that I linked in these slides. But here is the installation instruction for the toolchain. Likewise for the SDK, and yes, the same. Here I put the main steps to set up and run the environment once both toolchain and SDK are correctly installed. So if I can switch to my virtual machine, I can show you step by step the procedure. Okay. So from a fresh terminal, I just create a SDK. Okay, let's start with the first. So the export of the pulp toolchain path. GCC toolchain. So in my case, is in the default location. So PT-RISC-V. Okay. Then we can source the target architecture. So in this case, pulp open, which is the architecture that I explained briefly before. And then build the SDK. So this step is not needed if the GBSOC is not changed. So in this case, in fact, the procedure is quite fast. Okay, and then this is the setup is the environment is correctly set up. Okay. Let me return to the presentation. Okay. And then we can run our first example. So starting from an LO. And let's see the code. It's quite more long than a classical Hello World, but the idea is to show that you can, of course, use the Fabric controller to print the Hello, but also the cluster. And the result is the same. So if you look at the make file, we can see several things. The first is how we can communicate to the compiler the flags. So the one of the on top is for GCC, the C flags, and the one below is for the linker. Then we have an inclusion of a file which starts the chain of compilation and make files that I mentioned before. And must be present in all make files written for pulp. It includes several other files and environment variables from generic to chip specific, allowing to use and correctly compile every features. The last to mention is the make options that we could add as we want to include in the compilation phase and add the code. In addition, of course, to the default ones. For instance, we can try with verbose equal to one, which is a default one make flag to see what happens. Basically, you will see the compilation information in a verbose fashion instead of compressed as a default. Okay, switching again. Okay. So the tests, hello. Here I can just put make clean all run variables equal to one to see the compilation lines in a variable expression. Okay, and other information about the boot the boot code and partition of the memory, so other stuff. Okay. Let me return. Okay. Back to the code, basically for the fabric controller case, excluding the elegant way to call the test entry function from main and the printf routines, there is also an include of a file, a pncs.h file. And this is located in the common folder of PulpOS directory and contains the whole runtime stuff, including architecture definitions, PMC's APIs, and every useful function that allow you to program Pulp. Then there is the printf that send an hello. Okay, to use the cluster, for example, you can first of all open the cluster, which is previously initialized, as you can see from cluster conf init and open from conf functions. The former initialize the structure that contains the configuration of the cluster device, which can have different starting parameters depending from the particular chip. Then once it is initialized, it could be opened. And then the fabric controller can offload the task to the cluster that in this case is represented by cluster entry function, which basically forks PE entry function over a specific number of cores that we can set from make options. And finally, our application is sent to every course that we want, and then they can execute it. So we can test it again using use cluster equal to one and num cores. Okay, make clean all run, use cluster equal to one and num cores to set it, for example, to 8. Okay, this is the compressed fashion of the compilation line. And then here we can see the hello from different core ID, so from 0 to 7, and that's it. Okay, let me return. Okay, another way to evaluate the quality of the code and the bug. And the bug is of course the disassemble. So we can easily extract from make command using this statement, dumping it in a file, for example, or printing directly in the terminal. Extracting the disassembled, you can see how our toolchain compiled the code, and this is the case of fabric controller part. Which I put it in the slide, and now let's try to extract it for the cluster mode. So using this. Okay, so we can just compile the code and not running. Okay, this. Okay, this comment return the disassembled of every function of the entire PMC's stack. So the pcluster send task to cluster async and everything that are compiled in for this code. So there is a lot of stuff and functions that in which we can manage the PAL platform. Okay, this is the command. Okay, then another tool to debug the code that is very useful, especially to debug GVSOC, is the GVSOC system traces. These traces are basically a set of messages in which GVSOC describes what it is doing, where it is doing, and which is the context of the execution. So every component of GVSOC potentially print its messages, and typically there is more than one line per GVSOC event, especially for the complex components. To extract them, you can use the runner args option with minus minus trace and specifying the particular path to be extracted. To extract the whole set of traces, you can use a dot star as a path, and automatically in the build folder will appear the file with the name that you have chosen. In this case, log.txt. As I said before, there are different paths available in GVSOC, and here in the table, I have put some of them. Not all, but some useful. So you can see the cluster process engine, L2 memory, instruction cache, but there are many others. Okay, this is a set. A set of messages as a particular syntax, and if you understand it, is very very useful for debugging. In the first line, we have an example of a fabric controller executed instruction. From left to right, we can see the timestamp of the event from the boot. And this value is absolute. Then the cycles count that unlikely from the previous is located is local and referred to particular frequency domain in the entire chip and not, for example, for the external chip. Then there is the path in which the event occurs, then the address, which is a memory instruction in this case, and then the instruction program counter, the mnemonic, and the operands. And finally, the operands info, in which you could see the physical address for the memory and the values that the operands contain. As I said before, there is a distinction from the timestamp and cycles because one is absolute and one is related to the frequency domain, which are modeled in GVSOC as in hardware. Okay, for example, we can generate them for the core in the hello world example, dumping only the instruction of the core. Okay. So always here, make clean all run, runner arcs, minus minus trace. Oh, ah, okay, I miss equal. Okay. Okay, and these are the messages from the fabric controller and the instruction dumped on the instruction of the core. So this is all the instructions that the GVSOC are running in this example. This simple example, there is a lot of instruction. Okay, so you can see the every parameter of the particular syntax, so the instruction, the operand, and here the address of the operand and the and what the operand contains. Okay, and then the program counter. Okay. Okay, a little bit complex is a vector by vector multiplication. This example basically used the data of two integer vectors of 128 elements each, stored in the L2, computes the product, and then stores back the results. Notice that 128 times 128 times 4, because the data are integer, fit without problem L2, which is a memory with 512 kilobytes of size. Okay, the idea of this example is to see how we can profile our application also in GVSOC using the performance counters. In fact, to measure the performance in our system and look at its improvement, we have a set of performance counters, which is basically a hardware register that can count different events in the system. An event is a cycle, is a cache miss, an instruction, and so on. So they are particularly useful to evaluate the quality of the code, monitoring in fact the second order, also the second order effects. And to use the performance counters in an application, we just have needed of 5 PMC CPI. One of them select the kind of event out of several available, initializing and starting the counting, and stopping and reading the value. In this example, we have programmed the performance counter to figure out the cycles and the instructions by default. In the middle of start and stop API, we have to put the function or the piece of code that you want to profile, as you can see in this example. So let's try again let's try to see which are the performance of this example. So we have to switch the example folder. which is located in Perf, Perf Matmult. Okay, and make clean all run as usual. Okay, here, I have put just the number of instructions and clock cycles and the CPI, so the cycles per instructions. So in this case is quite high. So probably there is a second order effects that that reduce the performance of our exam. But back into the code, to the slides. And to the performance counters, you can find the enumerations, the enumeration in which there are every available counter and its position in the configuration register, located in the default.h file, which is located in RTOS, PMSys, PMSys API, and so on. Here, it also well commented to understand which are the features of the performance counters. For example, we have zero, which is the cycles that every core in the cluster the, is active and not in sleeping. Again, two is the number of pipeline stalls due to the load. And then three is for the jumps and so on. Important to notice is that some of these are useful only for the cluster evaluation. For example, the external load and store, which are 12 and 13, respectively, and that represent the number of L2 access from cluster cores. We should also notice that in the real chip, there is only one perf counter, but in the simulator, there is one per event, so that it can be the, that can be used at the same time. Okay, so yes, this tool is very important to preliminary investigate the quality of the code in a real scenario in which there could be second order effects. For example, our example. So we can use other performance counter to figure out non-idealities in this code. So let's try with verbos perf, which is a make with a make flag to discover which is the source of this bad IPC. But you can see here a fundamental anticipation. And yeah. Let me move to my virtual machine. Okay, so the same example, but with the verbos perf equal to one. Okay, here we can see the same cycles and instruction of before, more or less. And but there is also printed the load stalls, which in this case is 32,000. And yeah, basically summing the instruction and the load stall, you can see that the cycles are the cycle remain. Okay, so we have discovered the source of non-idealities. And okay, but yeah, we should now open open the disassembled to understand which is the critical point in which such load stalls occur, in order to try to eliminate them. But is out of topic now. Okay, let's move to a more complex examples to show you an important part of pulp system, which is the MicroDMA. MicroDMA is a programmable subsystem connected directly to L2 memory that can independently move data from memory to I/O and vice versa without involving the core. It is important to allow to the core to go to sleep or do other tasks while the data are transferred in and out of the chip. In the following example, we can see few BSP APIs, which are the drivers for our external chip, in this case connected via Hyperbus module. In particular, I'm saying about the HyperRAM and HyperFlash memory that we can use to store a huge amount of data and parameters as the weights of a neural networks. The example performs the same vector-by-vector multiplication of the previous example, but with vector sizes of 500 integer elements. So the resulting matrix will not fit L2, and then an external memory is needed to store there the partial results once they are ready. This involves several modules of pulp, and as we will see, the virtual platform well knows which is this component and simulating everything. Okay, so as I said before, using MicroDMA, the core may go to sleep or do other tasks, but also could wait the ending of the transaction, for example. We can call these different behaviors synchronous or asynchronous. The former, in this trivial example, requires that the partial results are totally transferred in HyperRAM after every computation. The latter instead can continue to compute partial output results while the MicroDMA copy them from L2 to HyperRAM. The last mechanism is called double buffering, and it is more complex than the other because requires a kind of context saving. And this is done using the task, an operating system concept that can associate to it a context, and then when the execution on the task is correctly done, can take and execute the next one. And we base our tiling approach on that, as we will see later with Alessio. The question is, how much can the double buffering improve the quality of the execution? So using again the performance counter, we can see the answer. So, moving to the virtual machine, we can use make clean all run verbose db equal to 1 to activate the I have to change the folder. Double buffering. So make clean all run. We will see the synchronous example, and we can see around 2.4 millions of operation, and a CPI quite high. And if use db equal to 1 to activate the double buffering, we can see around 1.4 millions of operations. So 1 millions of operation less. So it's quite, and a CPI more low. So it's quite good, this kind of stuff. Okay, here I put the same comments. Okay. Here I have just put an example of system traces of the micro DMA. In fact, I have dumped them using SOC / UDMA as a trace path, as we said, as we seen before. I have also isolated the first write request from the D-clock gating of the module to the micro DMA programming to execute the first transaction in the same example of before. So if we look with a quite degree of attention, the timestamp and the cycles is difficult, I know, but we look that in this period are passed around 382 micro DMA cycles in micro DMA domain, which is the core domain, so it's the same, and around 7 microseconds. So it's quite useful because you can see the every access and the offset of the micro DMA and the register of micro DMA, the clock gating of the peripherals and so on. So to extract, let's try to generate them for double buffering mode. Runner args as before, equal to SOC UDMA.txt, for example. Okay. These transfers are very, very, very large, so this procedure are quite slow, and the file generated is quite big, so pay attention with the standard text editor, because so I can try to open with less build pulp GCC RISC-V. You can find your file, and then the every traces for the execution of this huge application. So there is a lot of traces from micro DMA, also for the boot and for especially for the boot of the system from SPI and other initial stuff. You can find also the trace that you want. Okay, and this is for the microDNA messages. Okay, I will conclude the presentation of the debugging tool for code in pulp with another graphical tool to see what happened during GVSOC execution. And this tool is VCD plus a plotter. I'm not a super expert about this tool because I discovered very, very recently, and I will not focus on it because there should be a lot of materials on that. There is also a more detailed manual on VCD traces here at the link. Attention as before, because it's very useful for the concept, but the comment may be not updated. But you can use those in this slide. For example, with -- VCD as runner args, a raw file .vcd will be created in the build folder, together with the plotter file, in this case GTKW, to graphically see the raw traces. So let's try to generate them. Include this brief tutorial. Okay. Okay, as you can see, this command print the subsequent command to open with GTK waves the relative file that is created with the CD. Just copy the string. And GTK waves, which is a package included in the pulp SDK requirements, so you don't need to install it again. Okay, and there is a nice set of traces in which, for example, there is a cluster and cluster domain, SOC domain. Here we have only the fabric controller and the UDMA. So reducing the zoom and for example, placing here the marker. And then zoom in again. You can see the fabric controller and the UDMA activities. So very good fashion. Okay, let me return to the presentation because I have a more detailed slide. Okay, so for this example of synchronous and asynchronous execution. This is what we can see from these traces. The activities of the core and of the UDMA. In the screenshot above, we can see that the execution is disjoint and the two parts of the system are not working at the same time. So of course, this is the case of the synchronous example. Otherwise, in the screenshot below, we can see how the two parts are working together accordingly with the asynchronous mechanism. If we take the calculator measuring the delta from starting a UDMA activity and finishing it, multiplying by 500 because it's the number of transactions, and dividing by 20 nanoseconds because it's one cycle at 50 megahertz, we find an estimation of the differences between the two different strategies. And it is about 1 million of cycles. If we are assuming the difference measured with the performance counter in the first approach of this example, we can see how the two are comparable and are around 1 million of cycles of difference both. So at the end of the story, the things are correct, as we can expect it. This is my last slide. Thanks for your attention. Davide, if you want to say something.
Davide, I don't know if you want to take a short break between the two. I don't know. Otherwise, I can start immediately.
Well, I think you can start.
Okay. Okay, do you see my screen?
Yes, Alessio.
Okay, perfect. So, David, I can start. You are recording already?
Yes, I'm recording. You can start.
Okay. So, I'm Alessio Burrella, and I'm a PhD student in the group of Luca Benigni since 2 years. And I will give a brief introduction on our deployment of DNN on our pulp chips. Our idea comes from the real increasing trend of new neural network architectures that are coming recently. Mainly, we can see that there are many new neural networks that are made from companies and industry. But all these networks tend to solve very complex problems and require always a lot of memory. For example, if we see and if we think to a standard ultra low power chip, for example, I don't know, an STM32 and an M4 core, we will have normally 1 megabyte of memory. So using only 1 megabyte of memory, a very low amount of network can be supported. For example, a really small mobile net with a very low top one accuracy. On the other hand, if we can use an external memory and we can support the usage of the external memory, as Nazareno showed with the micro DMA, for example, we can support much more networks. Since the only constraint that we have is that all the weights have to fit this much more bigger memory. Of course, we cannot support really big networks like transformers, which require maybe, I don't know, gigabytes of memory of parameters, but we can support already state-of-the-art models like small efficient nets or big mobile nets. So also the mobile net with the maximum resolution, for example. So, to show a simple example of a network, you see here that there is a mobile net V1 with maximum resolution that use less than 10 megabytes of chip memory. So we can afford to support also much more bigger networks. What we will discuss in this presentation is our flow from the Unibo and also partially from ETH. And we want to, let's say, solve two main challenges The first one is how to automatically manage the on-chip and off-chip memory. So as I said, the on-chip memory is usually small, while the off-chip memory is bigger, but it's not trivial to use. So you cannot directly ask access to the memory, because otherwise you will have a very low throughput if you directly use the DMA without any trick and any double buffering application, let's say. And the second challenge is to not support, of course, floating point, which we can also say that is not more the state of the art for edge platform, but the efficient integer computation. So in this presentation, I will discuss 8-bit quantized neural network, and we will only talk about a tool that support integer 8 networks. For the future, we are also planning to support lower precisions, and we have already optimized backends for them, but we have yet to test internally. So this is the VUL tool, from the specification to the training, the quantization of the network, the deployment on the pulp, and finally the primitives, so the convolutional kernels, to say something, to say someone, and that are executed on the final platform, which can be both a simulator like GVSOC or a final chip like GAP8 or Mr. Wolf or others. The outline of this talk will be a bit more theoretical with respect to the previous one, and I will have a small and hands-on session in the final minutes of the presentation. So I will give you a few details about NeMo, that is our tool to quantize network, since it is not the key topic and the central topic of this discussion. And I will go more in details of Dory, that is the tool that manages, automatically manages the memory of pulp to efficiently port the networks on the final chip. Finally, I will also describe the backend that we use, that is pulp NN, and is optimized for the int 8 computation on a cluster of 8 cores. So to see the different parts that are solved by the tools, NeMo takes care about quantization and the network generation. Dory takes care of starting from the int 8 quantized network, will read the network, manage all the memory accesses to the different locations, and insert and compile the optimized primitives that are contained in the pulp NN library. So before starting, I will also want to thank all the people involved in the different tools. For the first one, that is NeMo, there are Francesco Conti, Marcello Zanghieri, Leonardo Ravaglia, and Lorenzo Lamberti. For Dory, I'm Alessio Burrello, and I will show all the other tools. And I deployed it with Francesco Conti and Torir from ETH. And the pulp NN library, which has been realized by Angelo Garofalo and Nazareno Bruschi. So starting from NeMo, the NeMo tool, what provide is a set of commands to both quantize post-training or with a quantization-aware training a neural network, a custom neural network. So it takes as input a PyTorch model or a ONNX model, and it quantizes the graph, and it also provides different tools to reduce the precision of different layers to different number of bits, provide tools only to do post-training quantization, or either provide also primitives to do a full retraining of the network. Note that while NeMo already is supporting a mixed precision quantization, so from 2 bits to 16 bits, from Dory, what we take in input by now is only an 8-bit graph. So what you have to do with NeMo, with other tools, is to produce an int 8 quantized network that then can be deployed by Dory. A bit of a really glance into NEMO. What it does is to provide a linear quantization of all the tensors inside the graph. And what it is important for our purpose is the topological structure of the network. So from NEMO, what does NEMO to a batch normalization and the ReLU node, that are the two nodes that use to requantize all the graph, let's say, is to divide them in integer multiplication, addition, and the shift. So a single tensor is first translated to a fixed point tensor and then to an integer tensor, which is multiplied by a quantum, which is the smallest unit representable by the fixed point quantization. The key things the key takeaway from these slides are not how NEMO works, but mostly what Dory wants in input. So Dory doesn't need a quantized, a fixed point graph, but wants an integer deployable network. So what takes in input are only integer values that are multiplied with other integer values. So there is no fixed point and no floating point deployed on our end tool. What these nodes are useful for are to change the dimension, let's say, of the quantum from layer to layer. And note that this quantum around the networks are always automatically changed during the training. So the only things that we have to do during inference is a multiplication and a shift operation to change, let's say, the image of the integer vector around the network. Now, moving to the, let's say, most interesting part and the most focused part of this talk, I will talk about Dory, and I will split the discussion mainly in four subtopics. So first we will talk about how an ONNX network is decoded by the tool and is written by the tool. Secondly, we will talk about the tiling that by now is done layer by layer. So we do not take into account any graph parsing. So we parse the graph layer by layer and we optimize layer by layer. And finally, we'll talk about how we automatically generate the C code, both of layers and of the total and of the full network. Okay, so on the left, you can see a graph of a network. You can see that there is a convolutional node, what we can recognize as an integer batch normalization and a ReLU operation, that in our case is the requantization operations. Then there are a lot of cast nodes and clip nodes that are generated by the ONNX because of the structure of the PyTorch code, let's say, and are not, of course, taken into account by the tool. So at the step zero, what we read is the first node, so it's a convolution. And since it is, let's say, a basic node that is present in our backend library, that is PulpNN, we create a new node inside the graph. Then each node is separately analyzed, and when a full node, so for example, here we recognize a batch normalization, so formed by a multiplication and addition, we can either create a new node or add this node to the previous one, fusing the two. So in our case, the convolution plus the batch normalization is supported in PulpNN, so Dory automatically recognizes it and generate the combined node. Then, as I said, it ignores the cast operations and it reads all the nodes of the graph. For example, here we see that it reads the multiplication, the shift, and finally the clip. And since it recognizes the ReLU operator, it also adds to the previous node. Then finally, when we find the Max Mull layer that cannot be fused into the previous convolution, Dory creates a new node that will be the second node of our graph. Let's say that, of course, the max pooling can also be fused to the previous one, but not in this current implementation. So in this implementation, in our backend library, we do not have a node that do the works of convolution plus batch normalization plus ReLU plus max pooling. So since we have only separate node, we have to create a new node in our graph. So what we generate from this first iteration of the coding of the ONNX graph, we generate a list of property of each node. So for each new node, we have the layer name, which says the basic type of the node that by now can be convolution, depthwise convolution, pointwise convolution, pooling, matrix multiplication, fully connected layers, and so on. And then if there are additional operators, like for example, batch norm and ReLU. Then we save all the parameters that are filter dimensions, stride, paddings, and so on. And we store also the parameters of the additional nodes. So for example, here we see the batch normalization, that is basically a multiplication plus an offset. And we store the two parameters. We say that there are these two parameters in the graph. And we do the same for the ReLU that is implemented by a simple clip and a multiplication followed by a shift. Note that these two nodes are written in this way, but then as this multiplication is not channel wise, we can also fuse with the previous multiplication, and then it is basically executed in the core as a single multiplication. So if you will dig inside the codes of PulpNN, you will not see this code, but you will simply see a clipator with a shift. Finally, we also read the input and the output, names of this node to link to the other nodes in the graph and recognize, for example, not straightforward networks, so also networks with branches and residual connections. So this is the end for the part of graph reading. So what we have now as output of this first phase is a new graph that has only nodes supported by the backend with all the dimensions and all the links between the different nodes. So we have yet an ordered graph, a feedforward graph, but with nodes that are supported in our library. The step two that Dory now does is the tiling of each layer. So what it does is to look inside each node and understand how much memory is necessary for this node and how to allocate it. So if L1 memory is enough, we will not perform any tiling. If L2 memory is enough, we will perform only the tiling between these two internal memories. And if also the L2 memory is not enough, we will also pass through external memory. So as we previously said, we have 512 kilobytes, and also as Nazareno said, for the internal L2 memory and 64 megabytes for the external memory. Here, for example, I'm taking as an example the Gapuino chip from Greenways. What we do to support the tiling is to keep take from let's call this an external level of memory, a tile of the image, so of the input image, transfer to a much more internal level of the memory, then process it and copy back the output to the external memory. The same thing is done with the weights, with the difference that the weights are only copied in when necessary to the computation. For the L3, L2 tiling, we implemented it and we decided to implement it on our chips for mainly the reason of the fact that the networks are getting bigger. So if we only support L2Memory, we can only support, let's say, toy networks, not even really sized networks for real problems. So supporting also L3 tiling is a key feature to support big networks with big activations. On the other side, of course, if we have to resort on this type of tiling, we will slow down the execution since the memory bandwidth from an external memory is much lower with respect to the internal memory bandwidth. So what we do to formulate this problem is simply a 1D transfer of different tensors from L3 memory to L2 memory. So first we check if the previous node has executed something from L3. So if the final output of the previous node is already in L3. So the things that we can do in this case is already starting to tile the input tensor because it is already on L3. So transferring all the input together before starting the node in L2 is equal, or better, sometimes is even better to transfer a tile and only process this tile while then delaying the transfer of the other part of the input image. Then the second check that we do is the weight tiling. So if the previous layer has no stored any output activations on the L3 memory, what we do is to check if tiling the weights is enough to fit the layer into our chip. So the question that we pose ourselves is if we reduce the number of the dimension of the memory dedicated to the weights in L2, can we fit the layer in L2? If the answer is yes, what we do is to tile the weights. So for example, we only take in, the first 10 filters and we produce the first 10 channels of output of our tensor, of our layer. And then we perform the other tiles. So we reduce the memory allocated for weights. And this is a common practice, for example, for layers with a lot of weights. So for example, for pointwise convolutions or for normal convolution, not depthwise one. On the other side, if the weight styling is not enough to fit the layer in L2, what we have to do is to tile also the output activation, which is the problem in tiling the output. For the execution of the current layer is basically the same because what you do is to process a part of the image. So process only a part of the node, produce part of the output and then store in the L3 memory. So you perform one, let's say DMA tile copy. On the other side, if you perform output tiling, the next node will have its input in L3. So you have to move back the activations to L2. So instead of have a single DMA transfer, as we have in the weights, where we have only to copy in from L3 to L2, here we have two copies from L2 back to L3 to store the output, and then from L3 back to L2 to take back the input of the new node. So basically you slow down the execution by multiplying by two the number of cycles that you have to perform with the DMA. Not the all these transfer are from the DMA point of view are 1D transfer because we see that performing a 3D transfer, so enabling much more complicated tiling schemes is not necessary in this case because it doesn't not improve performance from a computational point of view while it slows down the memory transfers. So now that we have seen the L3, L2 tiling procedure, what we do is the L2 to L1 tiling. While the first one is often not necessary for the L2, L1 tiling, I would say that almost all the networks that we deploy on our chips needs this type of tiling, because most of the layer does not fit the small memory of 64 kilobytes, that is the memory dedicated to the cores inside the cluster. So for this tiling, since it is much smaller, and now we transfer also very small piece of image, we decided to enable much more complicated schemes. So we do 3D tiles, and instead of doing it, let's say, in a greedy way, what we do is to formulate the tiling problem as an optimization problem. So we used the OrTool libraries to write a problem of optimization with some constraints and some heuristics to maximize. The problems, what it tries to maximize the problems, what we want to maximize is the use of the L1 memory. So we want to occupy as much as we can of the L1 memory. Of course, what we have also to respect are a set of constraints, both linked to the dimension of the L1 that of course have to be respected, and also to the geometry of the layer. So for example, if we take a style, a certain number of weights, we have to take also the same number of channels, for example, for the output tensor. The other things that we see also in these optimizations are a set of heuristics that are added to the cost functions that we maximize to improve the performance of the backend layer. For example, what we will see after some slides in this presentation is the fact that PulpNN parallelize its workload on the 8 dimension of the image. So one of the constraints, one of the heuristics that we want to maximize is that the number of rows of the image that we have in the tile is always a multiple of 8, since in this way, the workload of all the cores is balanced. So each core will take care of the same number of rows of execution. So all the cores will maximize the workload that do during computation. Okay, so now a few slides to show how the Dory tiler works in practice. So the first things that we do inside the layer is to transfer a first tile, so a first part of the input image, and some filters. What it is also shown in these slides is that we have always to input all the input channels and consider all the input channels in a single tile, because otherwise we will not respect the constraint of the PulpNN kernels, let's say. So the first step, so let's say T0 of our pipeline, we transfer the input tile and the weights tile, and after we perform the first computation at T1. In the same time that we perform computation, what we do is an async call to the DMA to copy the next tile inside a new buffer of the L1 memory. So in this way, what we do is to overlap, so to use the double buffering that previously Nazareno showed to completely hide the cost of the memory transfer between the L2 and the L1 memory, basically realizing a perfect caching system of our two scratchpad memory inside our chips. So the rest of the pipeline is mostly straightforward. What we do is to transfer the output tile back to the L2 memory, and in the meantime, perform the computation of the new kernel and the copy of the third tile, let's say of the third input tile, for a new computation. And that's the rest of the pipeline, mainly goes on in this way, overlapping the three tasks that are the convolutional kernel, the input copy of the input activation map, and the output transfer of the DMA from L1 to L2 of the output tensor. Okay, so we saw how theoretically the problem is solved by Dory. Now what Dory have is a new graph that not only has all the nodes, but has also the memory dimensions in the three levels of memory that are present in pulp chips that are L1, L2, and L3, and knows how to allocate the memory in these three levels of memory. Now what we do is to compile a layer template. What has this layer template inside? It has some memory copy and a loop over the tiles with a computational kernel inside. As you can see, these arguments with the dollar in front are automatically filled by the macro template library in Python and are filled with the parameters saved inside this pulp graph, that is the graph generating by the first two phases. Further, the layer template, what he has inside is already the name of the kernel that we have to call from the pulp and library. Also here I put a simplified representation, but also the kernels is chosen based on the name of the nodes inside the networks and also based on the parameters, because as we will see in the next slides, we will have also different backends to implement the same node. So as I said, we have here the first tile allocation, which is the T0 time, so the time zero that I showed in the previous slide, while after it starts the full tile loop where the three phases overlap. The first phase is an async call to the DMA DMA peripheric of the chip, which moves the input tile, the next input tile and weights from L2 to L1. Then we have the computation of the kernel, a weights for this transfer to end, and then the copy of the outputs back from L1 to L2. This is basically what it is executed in every layer, both for the convolution and for the pooling and for the linears and so on. Of course, all these indexes are automatically managed and the memory is switched by the template of the code that is inside the Dory library. Finally, what we do is the compilation of the network file, which calls all the layers from the layers that are previously being compiled. So from, I don't know, layer 0 to layer 10, the network calls them in order and manage the allocation of the memory of the L3 and L2 memory. So we see here the loop over the layers of this pulp graph. Basically here we have the loop over all the layers. We have the copy from L3 to L2 of all the weights. Not that this is independent from the L3, L2 tiling, because Dory basically assumed that all the weights are stored at the previous time that we compile our network inside the flash of the chip. So we store all the weights of the network inside the flash, and then we move to the L2 layer by layer the weights. Also this copy, even if not part of the layers, is double buffered. So we first wait for the peer reviews layer to end, and then we start the new copy of the layer for the nodes. Also here I put in a simplified version of the transfer, but here if the layer that we call is tied from L3, this movement of weights is not performed because it's performed tile by tile inside the layer. Here we have all the convolution layers. Here you see a strange percentage statement that is a statement in macro to make a for loop and simply report all the layers of the network. And finally, we will have the L2 memory management that is a complex function that automatically allocate and deallocate input and output buffers of the network, to make sure that the L2 memory is not fragmented, so we do not store all the input and output activations of the network, but we can overwrite the memory to minimize its usage. So from the point of view of Dory, this is almost the end of the theoretical part, and I will now give some details about the PulpNN library to show which are the main directions of optimization of this library. What we are targeting with this implementation, with this library, is the maximization of the data inside the register file and the exploitation of the parallelism to its maximum degree. So since we have 8 cores inside the cluster, what we want to do is to keep all the workloads of the cores active for as much time as we can. The representation that we use for this kernel is the HWC format. So as you can see from the picture, first we show, we store all the elements leading to belonging to the same pixel, but to different channels. And then we store the pixel, the right one, and so on. So we first store all the channels, then the width dimension, and then the height dimension. What we do so is to reuse, or better, try to improve the regularity of the kernel in the way that we can use special instructions inside the RISC-V, the RISC-V ISA, to minimize the cycles by exploiting all the specialized instructions. As we can see here, for example, we see the most internal loop of the PulpNN kernel. Here we have a kernel which uses 6 load and 8 dot products. This is the 8-bit version of the dot product, so it takes 4 8-bit inputs and multiply between each other and accumulate the results, while the load are loading words, so are loading 32 bits. Note that there are no sum of pointers, so the load, this p.lv load, what does is to make a load and directly increment the pointer of the register used to load the data. So thanks to the regularity of the kernel and this specialized instruction, we can save almost all the cycle to change the pointers of the tensors. So first we load 16 weights that correspond to 4 output channels and 4 input channels. And then we load two words, so 8 pixel that corresponds to 2 rows of the image and 4 input channels. In this way, we can maximize the reuse while using 14 register of the register file. So we use 6 register to store input weights and input activations and 8 register to store the output. Note that doing only 6 load, what we can do is a total of 32 max. So if we count number of operations that we do to perform 32 max are only 14. If we multiply these 32 max for the 8 cores, we will reach a very high performance, let's say ideal performance peak of 18 max per cycle on our platform. Basically this loop will loop over all the input channel and the filter size of the weights, and the different cores takes care of different rows of the image, so it parallelizes over the column dimension, so the 8 of the image. What concerns the PulpNN libraries today, we support the basic layers of, let's say, of convolutional neural networks, both all convolutions, point-wise convolution, depth-wise convolutions, linear layers, and pooling addition layer, and so on. And we developed a different version of the kernel parallelized in different way to maximize performance of different types of network. So for example, if we have very small input future map with a low height and low width, what we want to do is to parallelize over the channel output and not over the spatial dimension. So this is the reason behind the different implementations of these kernels. So let's switch to the small hands-on on Dory, on the usage of Dory. So here I reported the requirements of this tool, which are basically only Python and some libraries, and of course the Pulp SDK of Pulp. How a network is generated? First, it is trained in Nemo, and you can find a specific tutorial on this procedure on GitHub. Then the code is generated by Dory, and finally it is deployed and executed on the GVSOC or a Pulp chip. You can also find the full tutorial on the Pulp SDK, both concerning Nemo, Dory, and Pulp LN. Now I will only show some examples of deploying neural network from Dory. So let me switch to the virtual machine to show you some examples. Okay, so you should now see the virtual machine. Can you see it? Okay, basically I assume that you see it. So what you can do here is to generate different networks that are already stored in the Dory example folder. So you can see here that there are already some different networks that are internally tested for different projects or are well-known networks like MobileNet V1 or V2. So the first step is to generate a simple network with the default configurations that are present in the network generate file, that is the file that we can see here, which basically do the basic commands to generate a network. If we want to go a bit in details, so here we see that there are different arguments that we can specify that I will discuss later on a bit more in details. And then there is the main functions of Dory that is called, and it is the functions that generates all the layers and the C files to execute your code. As you can see from the output, when you generate a network, two log files are generated and are mainly the output of the first two phases that we see in the presentation. So from the first phase of the NNX decoding and the second phase of tiling. So for example, in the first file, we see the things that I showed in the presentation. So the name of the layer, the parameters of the layer. So three input channels, a filter dimension of 3x3. And 32 output channels, and we see all the parameters, so stride, padding, and so on. So this is made for all the nodes inside the network, and all the links between nodes are also reported. Not that this is a network without residual connections, so all the inputs are linked to the next one, basically. In the other files, we see much more interesting output, let's say, because we see how the layers are tiled between L2, L1, and L3 memory. For example, we see that the first node is not tiled from L3 because it already fits the L2 memory constraint. We can see here the memory of occupations of the tile, and we see that if we sum all the tensor occupation, we will have a lower memory of occupation with respect to the 512 kilobytes of the L2. On the other end, of course, you need to tile the layer from L1 to fit the L1 memory. Not here that the occupation of the L1 is 36 kilobytes, but what I specified in the network input is that he has to fit at most 38 kilobytes of memory. So the constraint is well matched, and we are also near to the maximum constraint. Also note that the dimension of the output buffer that are the ones that are important for the pulp NN kernel optimizations are all regulars. So we are, for example, we see that there are 48 in the H dimension, which is divisible for 8. So the workload of the cores is perfectly divided between them. If we look, for example, to another layer, for example, to the third layer, we see that here we have the tiling from L3 to L2. Why? Because the size of the network, the size of the tensor does not fit the constraint that I put in the input flag. So that is 380 kilobytes. So what does Dory here is to first perform a first tiling from L3 to L2 and then perform the tiling from L2 to L1 to perfectly execute the layer enabling the, let's say, double buffering. So a triple buffering from L3 to L2 and from L2 to L1. The output will be then stored back to L3, of course. So turning back to our example, the codes that it produced by this command is stored inside the application folder, and you can execute it basically as Nazareno showed. And you compile and you see that the tool allows to set different verbose level and to check difference, let's say, functional performance of the network. So first it checks the weights consistency, and then it also checks the input and output tile consistency from a single input that we pass to the network inside Dory. So Dory takes a single image in input and produce the series of output to see if the output produced from Python are compatible with the one produced by the input. So first, as you can see here, all the weights are checked. So are checked versus the checksum, the golden checksum of Python. And then at the end of each node, at the end of each layer, both the input, the output of the layer and the input of the next one are checked to be correct. Finally, at the end of the execution of the network, we see also the performance with the total MAC performed, the number of cycles, and the MAC that we execute for each cycle. As I said before, also you can enable different things inside Dory to both reduce the verbose level, because maybe you don't need it and you want only to deploy your network on your final product, and also to enable much more detailed performance also per layer. For example, if we enable the performance layer generation, we see that the code produced by Dory also reports the performance for each layer, which, for example, allows to see which layers are faster and which layer are slower, maybe because some layers has a strange, I don't know, a small dimensions that does not well fit the heuristic optimization of PulpNN. For example, if we have less than eight rows in our image, for sure we will not use all 8 cores to process our input if the kernel of PulpNN used is the one that is parallelized on the rows. So I want only to briefly show the output per layer, how it looks like. And you see that for each layer, we have the number of cycles, the number of MAC, the MAC cycles, and the number of cores that execute the layer. So you see that, for example, here we see very high performance for one layer and very low performance for the next one. It's because our library is faster in executing point-wise convolution than depth-wise convolution. This is an example of low performance that we see from this flag, activating this flag. The other things that you can do is to change the memory constraint that you want to pose. For example, if you want a smaller memory size in L1, you can provide your constraint to Dory that will try to solve the problem with a smaller memory. So we'll try to store the memory we'll try to use a lower amount of L1 memory and generate a network that consume less L1. Of course, if you generate a network with a smaller L1, what you will see is, of course, also lower performance because the tiles are smaller and the corresponding performance of pulp and N will be probably lower. Of course, you can also specify smaller memory constraint. For example, you can also specify 10K for L1, but not all constraint will fit the constraint that pulp and N has, for example, to have all the input channels. If the memory is not enough, the tool will automatically output a message error saying that, okay, there is not enough memory to generate your network. So you see here, it means that for a layer, it has not found any feasible solution to execute this layer inside the target pulp architecture. Finally, what you can do is also, you can also specify the network that you want to deploy and simply specifying the directory where the network is stored. So now, for example, I specified a different network and the code generated is the code of this network, which is a smaller network with lower layers. But you can specify the network that you want and you can specify also other folders outside the Dory directory. Note that for each example, what you need is both the ONNX file, so the file with the structure of the nodes, the one that I showed before, and some TXT file with the input and output golden activations. You need these only if you want the functional check. So if you want to check that the output of each layer is correct. Otherwise, if you want to simply execute your network, you have to specify in the verbose level that you do not want any check, and Dory will not ask for any TXT file with golden input and output. Okay, so switching back to the presentation, if I find it, okay. You see that all the things that I showed most are on the slides, if you want to go over the few things that I made inside Dory. And basically, I ended my presentation with this example. Thanks to everybody. I don't know, Davide, if you want to take care of the Q&A session.
Yeah, so let me stop here.